We're going to try something different here. And that is, we're going to put out a long video. The purpose of this is to give you practice in the most important element of all. And that is the capacity to spend long blocks of time in concentrated clarification. Some people call it contemplation or meditation. Doesn't matter what angle or emphasis your path takes, the capacity to spend long blocks of time is what will enable you to make enough progress to keep your motivation strong. And this is, motivation is all important. If you lose your motivation, you're going to quit. And if you only take it in short bits and pieces, you're not going to get enough clarification to keep your motivation going. So it's absolutely essential that you be able to spend long blocks of time. So here we are, and we are going to give you the opportunity to do this right here. Is just stick with it. You don't have to learn anything. You don't have to remember anything. It, in the doing of it, is the success. Because you'll strengthen your capacity to stay with it. Our present culture and the world culture is so superficial that it's promoting very, very short attention spans. Onto the next thing, onto the next thing. Click, 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 you know. And that's a drastically regressive type of culture, to tell you the truth. It's so superficial throughout the history of this planet. Those who have truly succeeded on clarification to the point when they've been able to truly free themselves from delusion, to choose a new idea, as I put it, they've been able to spend long blocks of time. They're very adept at that. And this was emphasized and valued above all other traits, all their characteristics in this planet, and any planet anywhere in the cosmos, is capacity to have a long attention span. So you can get deeper and deeper and deeper and more profound. Clarification becomes greater and greater and greater. When you do it this way, you realize you're making progress. And when you realize you're making progress, you will do it again. That's the secret. We hear a lot about the secret these days. I just told you what the secret really is. Long blocks of time equal great deal of progress equals motivation to do it again, which equals even greater progress, which means continued motivation to do it again, and that equals more progress. It's a positive spiral that you need to employ. On the other hand, if you take only short blocks of time and you're very quickly clicking to something else, you get hardly any progress at all, which makes you feel like, oh, why should I even bother again? I'm not really getting anywhere. And it's a negative spiral until your motivation dwindles. And you have to rekindle that fire. So, the idea came to me this afternoon after reading one of my subscribers' messages to me. I say, how do I respond to this? After a day of contemplation, got up in the morning I woke up and spent about 5 hours this morning in focused concentration. Most of the day I've been very focused and contemplating on what direction to go in, and this came up. Give this opportunity to the world to spend a longer block of time. As the greatest means of practice, no matter what spiritual path you take, no matter what you believe in, you have to be able to keep your attention for longer periods of time. And we're veering away from that in a drastic manner. So few are being taught that type of attention span. It's being devalued. You may have not even heard of it recently. It's a strange notion. Why spend a long period of time just listening to someone talk? And you think, gee, if there's something important to be said, they should be able to say it real quickly, and then I can move on to the next distraction, whatever. But I tell you this for sure. The great illusion that we call the Mahamaya of existence, the way that we're deceiving ourselves, is so ingenious and so befuddling to us because we want to believe in it. That's the problem, the strength of our desire to believe in it, that it's all plausible. To believe in plausibility is so strong that it presents an enormous barrier to us to taking the very simple and easy step of choosing a new idea. That's how we move on from one idea. The only way to move on, there's only one way to move on. This is symbolized in the Christian story of Christ saying, there's only one way. Which is true. There's only one way to move on from an idea, and that is to choose a new idea. The whole Christian symbology actually symbolizes this, but nobody has pointed this out. So it's pretty difficult to be a voice in the wilderness pointing it out, but it's true. There isn't any other way. So, it's simple, the resolution's simple, but our desire to believe that we can somehow replace reality with a new reality makes it seem virtually impossible to align one's awareness with the simple remedy, to realize how simple the remedy actually is. We want to do anything and everything but choose a new idea. In other words, our position is right now is to say, well, we're going to rule out choosing a new idea from the very beginning, a priority, just rule it out. And then from that foundation of ruling that remedy out, what remedy can we find? And then we go on our search. And we're still searching. And we're having a hard time finding the remedy. Something in us is bothering us. What is that? What's nagging at us? What's nagging at us is we realize we have arbitrarily denied the remedy. It's an arbitrary refusal to employ the only remedy that there is, choosing a new idea. So we've hamstrung ourselves, put ourselves in a straitjacket from the very beginning. And we haven't really made any progress towards finding another remedy because there is no other remedy. So how can we make progress towards a remedy that doesn't exist? It's impossible. We haven't really made any progress at all, and that's also bugging us. We're frustrated. We say, gosh, we've ruled out the remedy for so long, made such a great effort to deny ourselves the true remedy. And from all that great effort that we've made, we haven't made any progress towards another remedy. Unbelievable. We think we have. We have plausible avenues all over the place. If you look, you see a vast swampland of plausible possibilities that if you pursue that, you think, maybe I'll get somewhere. And those are the paths of existence. those are your destinies in existence as you go down those roads, infinite roads, all plausible, yet all completely futile, because there's only one remedy, not many. There are many ways to clarify this. In fact, all clarifications are unique to the one who is engaged in the clarification. It will come about in a unique way, with unique emphasis. But eventually, the clarity will rest upon the sovereign remedy, which is to choose a new idea. That's how you move on from one idea. If you're tired of one idea, you don't want to experience it anymore, you simply choose another idea. And then that automatically, that means you set the first one down as you choose the next one. It's automatic. That's how we were created. That's how reality works. We can't change that at all. So, because we have infinite creativity, the mind is the one who produces all experiencing for us with perfect spontaneity and creativity, flawlessly. We feel we should be able to come up with another remedy. We're trying to see if we can. We're testing the limits of reality to see if it holds true. And we're not sure. We think maybe we can change reality in some way. We don't know, but the truth is we cannot. Which is why you're listening to this, because you're bothered by something, frustrated by something. Maybe you've spent a long time on the spiritual path and still you have this frustration. How come I've not succeeded? I tell you though, your very effort on the path, bringing up this frustration and feeling of futility, is an enormous advantage for you. It gives you the leverage you need, because you can just connect the dots and say, okay, I have failed so far. Okay, I've made great efforts and I failed. Why? And you're willing to look at that. And the why is because you've denied yourself the only remedy there is, to simply choose a new idea. Then you can look into, well, why do I refuse to choose a new idea? And then that's another line of inquiry that actually bears fruit for you. Once you get into that, once you realize you've denied yourself the sovereign remedy for so long, then your inquiry begins to really have teeth and dig into what is truly effective and helpful for you. And you begin to come across all sorts of clever devices that you've used to scare yourself, to frighten, intimidate, terrorize yourself, so that you have refused to choose a new idea and keep fixating on existence, even to the point of saying that existence is the only idea there is, that there are no others and will never be another one. Even though that makes you feel uncomfortable. Then you try to get rid of this discomfort in all sorts of ways. Because really, you have an infinite amount of ideas at your disposal. Every moment you can choose any one of them, they're all available. Imagine a vast, vast library with millions and millions and millions of books. And you can go in there and you can choose any one of those books. They're all on the shelves for you. At any time, moment, you can put the book down you're reading and say, I think I want to read another book. Go over there and pull another book off the shelf and begin to read that. It's like that. Reality is a vast, infinite library of ideas. And you're completely free to experience any idea you want to. All you do is you choose an idea, and then mind presents that idea to you. Mind is the presenter of ideas. Mind is the creative, spontaneous, inventive, wonderful presenter of ideas, and spirit's the adventurous one that decides it wants to choose another idea. You know, it'll experience one and then say, wow, that was incredible, I loved it, but now I want to choose another one. And so spirit continues its wonderful tapestry of experiencing as mind presents these experiences that spirit chooses. That's how reality really works. But we're not doing that right now. We're fixated on just one idea. Have been for a long, long, long time. Many moments strung together of choosing this one over and over and over. Spirit keeps re-choosing this idea. Every moment spirit says, I gotta stick with this one. I gotta stick with it. And why? That's the question we need to ask. That's what inquiry is really for. Aim your inquiry in the right direction, and then you will find that you begin to see all sorts of pseudo reasons, plausible rationale why you've been fixated on this one idea and refused to choose a new one. And you'll begin to see, if you stick with it in a long block of time, that's very important. Long enough time so you begin to dissolve the intensity of this obstruction. You'll begin to see through it and you'll say, you'll turn it around and you say, that was backwards, completely false. No justification for that fear really at all. There's no basis in actuality, reality, whatsoever. It was merely a clever scare tactic that I was using on myself. And you'll come across all sorts of these very clever, buried defenses defending fixation on this one idea. That's tremendous inquiry, and you need to spend time on this, a block of time. Like, for instance, right now, maybe there's something on television, you know. But we're not watching that right now. We're listening to this instead. But you know that this is time better spent. There's no substitute for doing this. No substitute. I know that the cleverness of the mentation of existence will tell you that this is all a waste of time, that there's going to be some technology developed which will make all of this completely unnecessary. You know, technology is so good at replacing outmoded things, right? That we make a huge leap of faith into believing that spiritual effort will also become outmoded and technology will somehow replace that. That's a gigantic leap into an empty pool, because that promise is an empty promise. Because what you need to see is, why are you afraid to choose a new idea? And that has to be seen at the level of spirit and idea and mind very clearly. It's not a technical question. It's a matter of overcoming your fears and the deceptions you've told yourself. Technology doesn't really enter into that equation in any way. So you're not wasting your time. You're saving yourself time. The ones who are wasting time are the ones who are keep going down the primrose path of believing that they don't really need to put that effort in, that somehow it'll all be solved for them by taking a pill at some point. Those are the ones who are wasting time, because eventually they'll realize that all their hopes that this would happen was false, chasing false hopes, false promises, and then they eventually have to get down to it and begin to spend longer and longer blocks of time really concentrating and looking. Self-inquiry just means looking, really very keen looking. Imagine you're in a jungle somewhere in New Guinea or some great, you know, rainforest tropical jungle. and you're with some natives there, and you're walking along a trail, and they're pointing out all sorts of things that they see. They see so many creatures everywhere, and you're looking, you don't see anything. Maybe you hear a parrot screeching sometimes, but by and large, everything's invisible to you. And so you ask them, how can you see these things? And they say, well, we everything's camouflaged, but we have spent so much time in quiet observation that we've trained ourselves to be able to see past the camouflage, and we know where to look. We know where the creatures are hanging out, and so we're able to see them, very subtle. It's like that. So the insights are there. The defenses are there. The false plausibility is there. Everything, all the false fears are all present, and you can see them, but you must be quiet and still and non-reactive and keen and look in the right place in your conceptual belief system. You must be willing to be very patient. Maybe you'll look for a long time and nothing happens. You know those interesting artwork where if you stare at it in the right way with the right kind of focus, suddenly it becomes three-dimensional and you can see great depth, and it's amazing, and then suddenly you lose that particular plane of focus and it becomes flat again. You don't see anything. It's kind of like that, where you need to be patient and patient and patient. Keep a keen awareness in order to see a type of conceptuality that is bogus, that is telling you to stay away from choosing a new idea. It's dangerous. Keep saying, why is it dangerous? I don't think it is. Show me, why is it dangerous? Keep asking that question. Say, I don't believe it is dangerous. And I'm determined to see why I have misconstrued that and have deceived myself into believing that it's dangerous, because it is not dangerous. And this seeing is not easy because we're not used to it, because the terror that we feel in examining this is very difficult. So being non-reactive is very important. You're not going to react if you see the answer or if you don't see the answer. Either way, you're going to stay very calm. Let's say you see that very clearly. Aha, there it is. You still stay very calm, as if nothing has really changed. Just continue to view it. It may fade away. It may come back. Don't run after it. Don't chase after it. Keep your non-reactive calm there. Just sit. You don't have to be in any particular posture. Just be comfortable enough so you're not wiggling around. You're just calmly sitting, very still. You don't have to exaggerate the stillness, though. Just so you don't have to. Just so your body is not deflecting your attention as far as having keen awareness. Don't have to force anything. What's important is you stick with it in a longer block of time. Usually you cannot succeed over initial block of time, and then if you give it extra effort, that's when you succeed. You suddenly see through a deception, and you say, aha, okay, that one has been binding me. You know the story of Gulliver's Travels, where Gulliver the giant goes to the land of the Lilliputians, and these little people, he falls asleep, and these little people, while they're sleeping, they have stakes, so many little stakes with little threads into his clothing, tying him down. And it's not just one stake and a big rope. It's thousands and thousands of these. So Gulliver wakes up and he can't get up. He's tied down. And he said, how in the world could these Lilliputians, these tiny people, hold me down like this? Because there's so many, many, many little threads holding him down. It's the same thing. We have many, many little deceptions that we use. And as you work your way in, you'll see that they kind of come from bigger and bigger, more basic deceptions. For instance, like somehow choosing a new idea, somehow going to destroy the idea of free will, you know, something like that. Or we'll be annihilated. There are no more ideas. We've gotten rid of them. And ridiculous things like that. But they seem very plausible to us because we've been fixated on this idea for so long that for all intents and purposes, it's as if there are no other ideas, right? We think, well, it's been eons since we've ever seen another idea, so isn't it plausible to assume there are no others? You see how our involvement with this idea for so long has caused tremendous problems, because plausibility can go to work on that and begin to frighten spirit. Plausibility talks to spirit, says, spirit, you know, you used to believe in their other ideas, but just look at the facts. The fact is, it's been billions and billions of years since you've chosen a new idea, and you haven't seen any trace of one, have you? So why do you possibly believe that there are other ideas? Isn't it more reasonable to assume that our effort to get rid of all of their ideas succeeded? And spirit will say, wow, that really shakes me up. You know, I thought there might be, but now I'm wavering. So you see, the logic of plausibility causes spirit to waver and get very unsure, because spirit's been involved with this one idea for so long. It deep down, it has some doubts now. Now, how do you get past that? There's various ways. I know I can give you several examples. You can have an experience, an inner experience, where you become aware of another idea of reality. You see, reality can never be harmed. Therefore, you know it's impossible that that we could get rid of ideas. Ideas being part of reality, reality is incorruptible, cannot be fragmented, cannot be dissolved or corrupted in any way. Therefore, we know that the logic of plausibility is lying to us when it says there are no other ideas. It's lying. You're sure of it. But then again, logic of plausibility keeps getting you to waver, your spirit to waver, and saying, wow, it's kind of scary. I don't know for sure. That's one way. Another way is you come across someone in this world who has chosen a new idea, and they're effortless peace. They have effortless peace. And you observe them, and you realize that their peace is not coming from any effort at all on their part. That not coming from keeping their mind steady. Completely effortless. And then you begin to put two and two together, and you say, wow, it's almost as if this peace is coming from a different idea. And of course it is. And then you say, hey, that means there is another idea. And then it begins to dawn on you, wow, all this massive lie I've been telling myself, that all this plausibility that there are no other ideas to choose from, this is it, this is the only one there is, it's wrong. There's at least one other idea. And if there's at least one other idea, then you have to assume there could be others too. Maybe, you know, maybe we didn't wipe out all other ideas. It's like when you go to sleep and dreaming, and you think, wow, I'm afraid to wake up because I've wiped out the waking state. It's not there anymore because I'm not aware of it anymore. And yet, it still is there. You know, you're still in your bed. You're still sleeping. You're still there. So, if you are fortunate enough to come across a being that has chosen a new idea, then that really, really, really gets you motivated. You realize, aha, I'm deceiving myself about this. Then your inquiry begins to really take on some tremendous tenacity and depth to it. And you can have both of these. You can have an inner experience and come across some being, external being, with this effortless peace. Under all circumstances, nothing phases it, nothing causes any ripples or tremors in their peacefulness. It's seamless. It's effortless. Then you're on to it, you know. At that point, you're on to the truth. There are other ideas. You don't need to remain fixated on just this one that we call existence, life, universe, cosmos, whatever you want to call it. Duality, Mahamaya, the great illusion, the great dream. Just the effects of one idea. It's the dance of the dynamics coming from one idea. It's mind presenting this one idea. It's a big drama, big presentation, full stage. Cycles after cycles, deception out, deception within deception. But the way to break through that is simply to realize that there is another idea. That's the shortcut. It's the only way there is. You have to begin to be assured that there are other ideas that you can choose. Otherwise, there's no way in the world you're going to choose a new idea and set this one down. You will continue to try to make the best of this idea, which is what most are doing. It's obvious. Well, we can bring, you know, peace to the world. We can make the world a better place. That's trying to make the most of a bad situation, put a silver lining on things, because they have not yet realized that there are other ideas to choose, and that these other ideas are wonderful. You come across a truly awakened being that has chosen another idea, effortless bliss, effortless peace, and you see just how unbelievably wonderful the effects of that other idea are. And you say, wow, that is so much better than this idea. It's great. So you want to choose that other idea. You want to move on and be that way, experience those effects. So those are the situations that can happen. You can have a glimpse of reality. Can happen during the waking dream or the sleeping dream. When you're awake during the day or asleep during night, you can have this glimpse. You can see it for an instant. You can see reality. You can realize that it's untouched by dreams of its demise. And you can also come across a being that has chosen a new idea and experience that effortless peace beyond understanding that they have a portable paradise. Occasionally those come into this world. Those are real attention getters. For those who know the importance of it, if you're considering this idea, like, is it safe to choose a new idea? Are there any ideas? Did any ideas survive or attempt to wipe them out? If you're struggling with that, then when you come across one of these beings, you immediately, you sense it. Oh, I see something here. And your attention becomes riveted. And you begin to watch them. And you begin to notice, is the peace they have, is it just a clever trick? Are they controlling their emotions? Is that it? Or is it natural? Is it effortless? Begin to try and make discernments like that. And the more you carefully you watch, the more you realize, oh my gosh, it's natural, it's effortless, it's not coming from existence, it's not coming from the idea that I'm experiencing right now. It's coming from a different idea altogether. Now, they may not say that for various reasons. It's hard to explain why various teachers teach the way they do. It has to do with the defense systems of those that they're involved with. They may say pretty much what others expect them to say or want them to say. But all along, they're also present for those who have the eyes and the ears to recognize why they're really here. You don't have to ask them any questions, and you can just see it immediately. You say, aha, what's this? And others will be asking him all these spiritual questions. Should I be eating vegetarian? You know, I have this relationship that I've been in for a while, but it's not so fulfilling. And, well, you know, and on and all these things, questions, you know. And the teacher is answering them very nicely. And you think, oh, maybe that's what it's about. But that's just a superficial. For those who are wise and keen and onto it and are trying to find an answer to the most crucial question there is, are there other ideas available still to choose from? And in the choosing of these other ideas, will you get an presentation by mind that is flawless? Or has mind been damaged? Is mind crazy? Has mind become dysfunctional? Which is another great fear we have, which the dream that we're experiencing now, this idea, it seems like mind has gone crazy. But that's actually, it's the idea itself is crazy. It's not mind. Mind's not crazy at all. And you see in these beings, you see their mind, the mind is presenting this beautiful piece to them flawlessly. And you say, okay, everything's working just right for them. And that gives you tremendous assurance and tremendous motivation. And you begin to work on your fears concerning choosing a new idea. And you begin to realize, you know what? I'm getting pretty close to finally ridding myself of this terrible idea that I chose, this crazy idea of trying to replace reality with a new reality. It's caused me nothing but misery, to be honest about it. Those who are getting close to choosing a new idea tend to be much more honest about existence and tend to be much more negative in their characterization of it. They're not afraid to really say, wow, I just hated this idea. Just awful. Just terrible. Can't stand it. Nothing but suffering. Nothing ever happened, really. Just 100% misery, confusion, despair, fear, awful. They can say those things, but those who think that there is no other idea, this is it, they are loath to say that. They're loath to hear it. They don't want any part of that because their focus is on trying to make the best of a bad situation, trying to put a silver lining on it, trying to put some icing on it. So they don't want to hear any negativity whatsoever. You can tell the difference. Very, very easy to tell the difference. Because they're not yet searching to see if there are other ideas. In their mind, in their spirit, they believe there are no other ideas, or they're pretty sure of it, or they're very worried that probably there isn't, so they don't want to risk it. They want to stay very positive, optimistic, say, yep, we can make this planet great, yep, all our carbon atoms are going to mutate and we're going to be perfectly happy, just like that, or everything's going to ascend and we're going to be blissfully happy. We're going to be able to produce a utopia, free energy. We're going to be able to heal all disease. You know, on and on and on and on. No more war. We'll live in happiness forever, ever after here in this cosmos. That's trying to put a silver lining on it. And all of that will seem very plausible. It's like a mirage. It looks very real, and as you walk toward it, it keeps retreating. It's like a rainbow. You're going towards the rainbow, and it just, no matter how fast you go, it keeps receding from you. And yet you see it so beautiful, you think, wow, if I can just get to the end of that rainbow, I'm going to find the pot of gold. But you never do. So you see a difference. That those, like I said, those who really been on the path and they really realize now that there is another idea, they're sure of it. And you know, it's just a matter of time before they gain the necessary conviction to choose a new idea. They're not scared about, you know, cursing out existence and saying, wow, what a huge mistake that was. Just total, terrible, terrible choice to choose that idea, that awful, crazy idea of trying to replace reality with a new reality. That is just the worst thing ever. Never going to do that again. Boy, am I going to be glad when I drop that idea and choose another one. That is going to be great. Can't wait. Can't wait. No value in this idea whatsoever. Zero. Just some faint tinges of beauty, but that's because it's impossible to experience any idea without at least some tinges of beauty and spontaneity and creativity. So there are faint echoes in this idea of reality, the wonderful richness of reality, but very faint. And they're more like tantalizing than anything. So but we don't want to spend too much time cursing existence. A little bit's okay, but mainly we want to focus in on what's our reluctance to choose a new idea. Where's that coming from? Thin out the reluctance. Lessen the fixation with existence. That happens during your experiencing in this life. You come across all sorts of situations, and if you take it the right way, you'll begin to overcome your valuing of the world in strange ways. You might find yourself, you know, in mansions, unbelievable riches around you, and you are there enough so that it kind of becomes commonplace to you, and you're really not that interested in it anymore. And you move on to something else, and those things that you value in this world, you will find yourself coming in contact with those in such a manner that you begin to thin out your attachment and attraction to those things, to those situations, to the point where you realize, there's really no value in that. It's not worth dying for. It's not worth remaining fixated on this idea for. And the more you decrease your value of the world, the more you feel like choosing a new idea is the right thing. Your reluctance gets lessened. And that's real progress. So you can make progress in many different ways every single day. When you go to sleep and your head hits the pillow, you should feel that you have made significant progress that day. And every single day should be like that, because you're on to it. When you're onto the scent, you know, when the hound dog, the coon dog, gets onto the scent, boy, they don't get off that scent, do they? Once they really catch it, they're on it. And they don't stop until they tree the coon. So, just like that, on the spiritual path, once you realize that there are other ideas, and ideas have not been harmed, and you have the option to choose other ideas, other existence, you're onto the scent. You're like that hound dog that's got that great nose. And you're not going to stop until you really, actually do choose a new idea. So, making progress every day is very, very important. If you don't make it, you feel like you wasted an opportunity. So every day is a great opportunity. No matter what happens in the day, no matter what distractions occur in the day, no matter what noises happen, doesn't matter to you, because you're not trying to put a silver lining on existence anyway. What does it matter if things aren't perfect here for you? You already know that. It's a place of misery. It's a place of constructivity and destructivity, of convergence and divergence. endless cycles, all trying to prove there's some power of destructivity capable of wiping out reality. And now you know there is no such power. So it's all useless. Why even bother with trying to judge any of it? You don't need to judge any of it. If all efforts are futile, if there's a goal that cannot be reached, then all efforts to reach that goal are equally futile. There's none that are less futile and others that are more futile. So there's no reason to pass any judgment on any of these efforts. Waste of time. Judgment's a waste of time in that way. What we're really judging is what is more effective to maintain our fixation and what is less effective to maintain our fixation. But instead of taking it that way, keep focusing on what is it that's frightening us from choosing a new idea. That's a better way to look at it. Why do we feel threatened? If we choose a new idea, it's going to cause chaos, huh? We're afraid of chaos, lack of continuity, things like that. The fear of a lack of continuity is crucial. That's what really blocks us. And that's why I recommend choosing the idea of not trying to create a new reality. Not trying to get rid of reality and create a new reality. That maintains continuity. A sense of continuity. That's why I say this idea is the best one to choose. It's like the flip side of the one we chose. We chose the idea of trying to get rid of reality, trying to negate reality so we can create a new one. Let's choose the idea now of not trying to negate reality. And so everything that we previously have made, all these constructs, the purpose is to prove there's a power of negation. Now, since we're not trying to prove any power of negation at all, we're not trying to prove anything, not trying to negate anything, we don't even need to negate negation. Not even trying to negate that. We can then, everything, all the constructs and the destruction of all those constructs, all of it is equally covered with a seamless blanket of peace, of pure non-negation, of no effort whatsoever to get rid of anything or negate anything. The good, the bad, and the ugly doesn't matter. It's all equally covered with this perfectly gentle blanket of our atmosphere of peace, resting equally upon all, without exception. And this rests upon the self, and it rests upon the non-self. Doesn't matter whether you find a self within or no self within. Either way, this peace rests on anything, whatever concept there is, or lack of concept there is. Identity, no identity, whatever beliefs, this peace rests upon all of that. You don't have to change anything. You don't have to have any specific beliefs one way or the other. Because this non-negating, perfect, seamless purity of immaculate unruffledness, tranquility, peace will rest upon everything equally. And yet all the constructs are still there, the tree's still there, the plane is still flying overhead, the bushes are there, the flowers are there, your body's there, your thoughts are there, your emotions are there, everything's there. You don't have to do anything with them, because the peace will rest upon all equally. All the noises can still be there. Whether they're peaceful noises or discordant noises, doesn't matter. But this isn't a trick of the mind, it is actually the effects of another idea. You can't get those effects from the idea we're presently fixated on. It's impossible. Many have tried. Many have used magic to make it seem like they've got it. You know, you see a magic show and it seems that they're doing impossible things on the stage there. But you know it's all a trick somehow. Somehow they're fooling us all. So there are many attempts to have this effect of perfect peace within the idea, the effects of the idea that we're fixated on, but it's impossible. It's only a good show. It's only superficial. It's only makeup. Make believe, not real. But when you come across one who has chosen a new idea, then you realize, oh, it's those effects are real. They're actual. It's no magic show here. That's what you realize. That's what you have to look forward to. Real motivation. You see, it's easy to spend this time, isn't it? Not difficult. You can do it. Because the topic is interesting, is compelling. Because your determination to get free of this idea that you've been fixated on for so long is very strong determination. And you're tired of being intimidated into maintaining your fixation. And when you know it's possible to get free, then you will pursue that freedom relentlessly. It's no big deal to spend a block of time on it. Because if you don't, you're going to spend your time some other way, for sure. The delusion is that somehow if we spend our time flitting from one thing to another, real quick, changing the channel, you know, over and over and over, click, 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 changing the web page, many, many different web pages, that somehow we have made much more progress than if we just stay put on one channel, one page. See, that's an illusion of progress. Because if you find that which is providing the right information, then staying with that is the way you make tremendous progress. And if you leave it and you go on to all sorts of superficial distractions and magic shows, you're not getting anywhere. You're wasting your time. And what a beautiful evening it is here. We're out in California, Bay Area of California. It's a splendid September evening right now. Couldn't ask for a better time to launch this effort here. World is still active, there are cars, there are people moving around and such, but that's the way the world is, isn't it? It's always changing, it's always moving, it's never still. So you have to take the time to have your stillness in the midst of all that. You have to use your will to do it. Even though the world swirls about you, you have to impose your will on your time, how you use it. That's difficult because you'll feel embarrassed or odd or uncomfortable because you think, oh, they're disturbing my peace of mind here, and they may wonder, what am I doing? They're out there chasing after rainbows, putting silver linings on everything, gilding the lily, and you're here just listening to something or contemplating, choosing a new idea, and forget about all this. You realize it's all garbage. The world is 100% garbage. Dust to dust is what it really is. It's all just dust. Dust assuming many beguiling forms, but dust nevertheless. But you have to use your will, not in an angry way or bad, but simply keep your nerve and keep at it. Keep at it. Don't get thrown off. Don't let yourself get intimidated. Find a place where you feel you can do it. Use a block of time up. Whatever device you can use. Maybe you have a TV on your room. Put like headphones on that block it out. And spend time contemplating. And people think, oh, you're always watching. She's watching television. Great. You know, good to hear or listening to music or something. It seems like you're just doing doing what you're supposed to be doing according to the world, but you're really spending time and focusing in. All those things are possible. You don't need to let people know what books you're reading, what channels you're looking, how you're using your time. You don't need to be forthcoming in all of that. Because if one is not aware that there are other ideas to choose, then they will think you're crazy, like you're wasting your time, which in this world is the definition of craziness. It's one who wastes their time seems to be very crazy, very stupid. And people want to help you out and say, oh, gee, you're really wasting your time. Let me help you out and let me have you chase after rainbows with me. And then you'll be happy. You'll get that. So it's best not to advertise what you're doing, because that's what will happen. You'll get pressure to go chase after rainbows instead of just sitting quietly and focusing in on why are you so reluctant to choose a new idea. Where's the reluctance coming from? Where's the fear coming from? How are we frightening ourselves off of what is obviously the right thing to do, the safe thing to do? Why do we cling to this awful idea of existence? So you're just tracking that down. That's all you're doing. That's very simple. You're just tracking it down. Where's the resistance coming from? That's your topic of interest. That's it. Where's the resistance coming from? You know most people are not interested in this topic, so why even bother bringing it up? Instead, just spend your time focusing on where is this resistance coming from? Because as long as you can't find the answer to this question, you will continue on in time and space and existence. So you might as well get down to the task and do it. Track it down. Be an excellent tracker. Go down the path into that valley of fear. Find out what's down there. You'll find out it's all bogus. Nothing to it. Ridiculous. Nonsense. Rubbish. Garbage. No truth to it at all. All defenses. No truth to it whatsoever. You're perfectly capable of choosing a new idea. All ideas are perfectly available to you. Your mind is flawless. Every reality is still flawless, still perfect. All systems go. Nothing stands in your way. That's the truth. So keep working at it. Keep tracking it down. And when you've done your bit and it's been very effective and you've really put your time in, then at some point, you know, you do need to take care of some things, then that's what you do. You don't have to prove anything. You don't have to put in anything extraordinary just to prove that you're really extraordinary at it. Just try to maintain a normal, balanced life where when you have to take care of something, you have to take care of it. And then get back to your contemplation, your tracking, as soon as possible. So this evening we've spent the time here. I don't have to be checking the news on the internet right now. I could spend some block of time right here taping this. But at this point, I need to go in and download it to the computer and go through the whole process of turning it into a video on YouTube. So that's something that I will do. And I think it's been a really great opening experience here. I look forward to producing another one soon. Very good. That's it.